Margaret Crook Callister, my step-grandmother and wife of my grandfather, Joseph Platte Callister. She was very much involved with our young family. Right from the start of her marriage to Grandpa, she chose to have all of us refer to her as Aunt Margaret. Grandpa Callister died about a month before I was born, 25 days to be exact. Grandmother Callister, Sarah Elizabeth Christensen, died about 11 years before he did. Grandpa Callister, Joseph Platte, and Aunt Margaret were married about 4 years after Grandmother Callister died. They lived in the farmhouse that we all grew up in, on the South Track Farm, about 3 miles south of Delta. When I was old enough to walk, I was sent through the hayfield from our little house going southwest on an old trail to fetch eggs that Aunt Margaret got from her chickens. The picture here of me was about where the trail was, but it was a little later they turned me loose to scrounge for food. Their chicken coops were set up to house many chickens. I remember one day I was given the eggs in a paper sack to bring home. I had gone a little way when I dropped the sack and broke nearly all the eggs. I have recalled that episode many times since. It was a big, scary event for me. I do not know which would be the best trouble for me, going to face my parents or back to face Aunt Margaret. I decided on Aunt Margaret, and it was not nearly the awful thing I had imagined it might be. I am not saying that I was treated as a hero. When she moved uptown, it brought some new and good things to us kids. We would often stay overnight at her house and enjoy her hospitality and activity like movies, ice cream, candy, and games. Her home was very close to the railroad station and tracks on the northwest side of town. I remember many times going with and without her to pick up bits of coal spilled out of the train cars onto the tracks. The pieces were placed into a sack one by one and hauled back to the house for use in the coal stove for cooking and warmth in winter. Many times we would crawl under a parked train to get over the tracks on the way to town or to get where coal pickings was best. Aunt Margaret crawled under the trains as often as we did. I remember one time I was standing right next to the big steam engine when it let off steam, which made a horrific loud noise. I found myself running away from the train about a block away, unconscious of anything. I had a friend next door to the west, Glenn Gardner. In the picture, you would suspect that we had been in coal dust or worse. I don't recall why I was so unusually unkempt that day. Maybe we were getting ready for a show we were going to be stars in. There was an outhouse set far back of the house to the north. It seemed a long way, especially in the winter, and she always had a pan or a bucket, so when the weather was too bad, we could use that. She liked to go to movies as well as I did, so that was an incentive to stay with her. I remember going with her to Gone with the Wind, made in 1939. I remember it being very long, 238 minutes, and that she may have taken me to see it more than once. She was a very active and fun person to be with. She was as excited to get out and do things as we were. One time she and I went out to Salt Air. We started out on the little train that left from Lagoon. At that time, for some time after, they had the scariest and most unstable roller coaster anywhere, we thought, and I still think. Well, she had to go on the thing, of course. I was a brave young man and had to play the macho part. I said, sure, I want to go. It was more than a thrill. It was possibly the end of the world for us all. Each vertical fall resulted in her standing straight up, screaming for the fun. I was holding on to anything available to avoid spilling out of the bench. When we finally came to a stop, I was so thankful and proud to have survived such a challenge. It was not the end of it. She wanted to go again. It was the least desirable thing I could have imagined. What could I do to escape and still save face? Here I was, a young man afraid of nothing except getting back on the killer, but I knew I would have to play my part and act as if it was a good idea. It was almost worse the second time around, but I could still tell people that I had braved it twice. She would often let us kids act like we were playing on her player piano. I remember some of the songs we sang, like A Little Spanish Town. She was special to me. She made very good oatmeal cookies, best eaten hot off the cooking pan. We visited interesting people, played card games and board games, and challenged each other at recall of states and capitals as well as counties and county seats. To this day, I remember Utah State Capitol, Fillmore. And sometimes I even got to ride in her Model T Ford when it was one of the few around. I remember running alongside at the same speed she drove it. probably as fast as it would go. I went roller skating at the Palomar building near where she lived. I recall how I never got very good at it. The only way I could come to a stop was to crash into a wall or some other unlucky skater. She tried to get my dad to buy me a bicycle. We were both pretty determined that I was the most left-out boy in town. Actually, it was not a real big thing to me. Most of my comrades in the farm community didn't have one, and besides, it didn't take a genius to see that it was more important to send kids to school with shoes. I did have access to a horse to ride about any time I wanted to. Often the horse I rode was really a regular workhorse like the one in this picture with Grandpa Joseph Platte Callister. We would take off the harness and it became our riding horse. Later, when she moved back to Heber City, Dorothy and I would sometimes pick her up for a visit to Delta on our way home from Utah State University. She did really miss family and friends there. I think she felt obligated to be in Heber City to help care for her two single nephews who lived there, Grant and Merrill Duke. She loved each one of the children as they came along. She would tell two or three of us that she expected us to sing Juanita or another of her favorite songs at her funeral. Then in a couple of years, she would ask the next group coming up to do it. I'm pretty sure that Marilyn and I were the first asked. I will never forget her kindness and the fun times with her. I sometimes felt a little cheated out of time with Grandpa and Grandma Callister, but Aunt Margaret certainly was loving and helpful to me and all of our family.